Friendly Fran Drescher.
Look at you. You're gorgeous. Gorgeous.
Hi, Franny. You look terrific, kid.
Oh, thank you so much. I feel great.
Do you?
All is good,
yes. Oh, good, yeah. I read the book and it scares you a little bit, you know?
It's meant to. I mean, you know, it took me 2 years to get diagnosed with my cancer and 8 different doctors.
But you always knew something was wrong. What took them all so long?
They all thought that I was entering some kind of an early menopause because the ultrasound never showed the tumor. You know, there are very few tests that are 100%.
Mm-hmm.
And the one test that is 100%, which is basically a DNC, which would have totally told them what, you know, the condition of my uterus was in, nobody wanted to give me because they all thought if they didn't see anything in the ultrasound,
yeah,
then they would go with hormone replacement therapy. And over the course of 8 doctors, I did 4 different hormone therapies that either made me feel terrible or nutty or exacerbated my symptoms. Terrible. And, you know, really what I learned about the whole thing is that, because, you know, my doctor's no different from anybody else's, but we have to take control of our own bodies. We have to find out what these symptoms could possibly mean and what tests are available.
What exactly were the symptoms?
Well, staining between period and cramping after sex is classic symptoms of uterine cancer. My surgeon said, staining between period biopsy, that's what everybody teaches you at medical school. She said, what happens between medical school and practice, I'll never know, but it never should have taken you 2 years to get diagnosed with this. But the doctors, and you know, the 8th that finally diagnosed me after I was like having terrible reaction to the birth control pill that she gave me, thinking that that would regulate me, confronted her because she came to the hospital thinking, you know, acting like, you know, I mean, I was grateful that she ultimately diagnosed me, but, you know, I still had...
You were losing precious time.
Yes, and I really wanted to confront someone why. So when she came to the hospital acting like she was, you know, all the heroine in my story, I said, you know, I haven't been in therapy all this time to not confront you with what is laying on my heart. And I said, why didn't you just give me the DNC from the get-go? You weren't the first doctor I went to. You knew I had these symptoms for 2 years. Why didn't you just do that? And she said, well, we tried to go the less invasive route first. And I said, less invasive? You know, it was a 2-minute test, and it would have conclusively ruled out or diagnosed it. And she said, well, I must, if it makes you feel better from here on in, I think that if someone comes in with your symptoms, I will do that before
I made it easier for the next one, but you had to go through the pain. What is it like being in the hospital? You spent a lot of time in and out. Being a celebrity and being in the hospital. Is that good? Is that bad?
Well, you know, I don't think being a celebrity helped me through any of this. I mean, people think you're a celebrity and you can get the best of everything, but actually my surgeon said that celebrities and politicians get the worst health care because nobody really wants to tell you there's something wrong with you. They want to think that you're okay, and they're blinded by the fame. I mean, I got a blood test not 2 weeks ago, and I called 3 days after and said, you know, I'm very upset, but they never sent it in to the lab. Meanwhile, I'm black and blue here, and she managed to tell me how much she loved the show. But, you know, it's like she lost her focus. If I were, you know, someone that wasn't famous, maybe I'm sure the woman has taken blood and sent it into the lab a million times. She got very flustered. Mm-hmm. She forgot to do it, and he said, and the blood is useless after 6 hours. So that was like, you know, a complete waste of time, and this happens over and over again. And in the hospital, of course, you know, everybody was very nice and everything, but while I was still there, it was already in the tabloids that I had had the cancer. And this is after making the best of efforts of going in under an assumed name and everything like that. But somebody sold me out. And, you know, it's very difficult when you're already down to then be exploited. But in the end, I think that it wasn't the worst thing because it... By being outed with the cancer, it forced me to face the fact that I am a woman that had cancer, and that the story is out, the world knows it, and so now I can tell my story without trying to deny that.
So your health right now is?
Hopefully, God willing, I'm essentially cured. With uterine cancer in particular, a radical hysterectomy, and mine was in stage 1, which means there was absolutely no spread. But the most important thing with any post-cancer operation is that you have to continue to go for your checkups. I go every 3 months religiously. Very important, because early detection is, you know...
You hold your breath when you go in?
I do. I still do a little bit. I mean, it gets a little easier, because with each time you go to the physician and she tells you you're okay, that raises the odds in your favor that there will not be a recurrence. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So after the surgery, they said it was like 95%, which, you know, is very nice. And I go in for 5 years. You go for 3 years every 3 months, and then for 3 months, and then for 3 years every 6 months. And, you know, it's just something that I do.
That you do it.
But
so
I feel great, and I'm very happy.
You look terrific.
The book is called Cancer Schmancer, and incidentally, my wife, Troy, is visiting your home out on the coast.
On HGTV?
HGTV will be on next Wednesday night.
Oh, isn't that great?
Yes, you've got a lovely home.
Yes.
And a new boyfriend of the Friendship Radio. There's a lot going on. Don't worry about friendship.
Only you could write a book and call it Cancer Schmancer.
We'll be back with Bill O'Reilly in a moment.